Okay, I think we're live now and you can see us. So, hello everybody.
Hi.
Hello, hello, hello. Are we live yet?
Yeah, yes. We should be on screen in 60 seconds.
And,
yes, we are.
So, hi everybody. Welcome to this live stream of Voters Without Borders. Here with part of the team. Maybe we didn't choose the right moment as of today, of yesterday, everybody can go out again. So, but we think it was the right moment for us because we reached the 500 people in the group. So we are happy for those 13 people following us right now, but the video will stay there. So hopefully you will all have the chance to watch it. So I won't hesitate and just present myself and the rest of the team will do the same. I'm Anna from Italy and...
guys, I'm getting reports that there's a background noise which is quite loud.
Can you unmute the microphone?
Let me mute myself.
Yes, everybody.
Yeah.
Okay. Does it work better? Yeah. So first of all, I think we should thank Bastian for setting this up. You were very efficient to do this in a very little time. And yeah, so getting back to me, Anna from Italy, I've been living in Germany for 3 years, and now I've moved to Belgium, where I hope I will stay for a while and work. Nothing else here, part of the team. So I'll give the word to my other colleague, Claire. You have to unmute.
So yes, hello everybody. I'm really glad to be there to meet you, like all of you. I'm French and I'm working now for 3 months to launch this SEI and I hope it will work with all of you, and I hope you enjoy our initiative, and I'm really glad to be here on this.
Thank you so much, Claire, and yeah, maybe Robert, go ahead.
Hi, I'm Robert. I'm from Romania, and I've studied so far in UK, and now I'm in Belgium finishing my master's. And I've joined this initiative along with 10, 12 other people like me who believe in the European ideal of free movement, in the European ideal of equal political rights, and in the European ideal of European citizenship. As we believe in this European, as we believe in the principle of the European citizenship, we also believe that voting should also be tied to it in an equal manner between Europeans and national citizens. And therefore, I think we all found a solution of how to achieve this. And I will let my colleague Bastian present to you how we're going to do it. This is about the ECI itself. Thank you.
Yes, thank you very much, Robert. And you are totally right that this whole thing, it's about empowering European citizenship as a principle. And so what is the latest instrument added to European citizenship, Bastian? What is the latest right that many people don't know, and we thought about it and we think that it has very powerful, much potential, but it is unknown. So maybe you can go and explain what is an SEI and then we will talk about our CI, Borders Without Borders.
Yeah, so hello everyone, I'm Bastien, I'm French, just like Claire, and I went to Brussels before the crisis. I spent a good time there with the team and tried to prepare as much as possible the ECI. So I will try to explain you quite simply what is an ECI and what is our project. So EU citizens have a right, thanks to the European treaties. One of these rights is to create initiative as we do. People from seven countries have to be together and...
Bastien?
Yes?
Sorry to interrupt, but we cannot see you at the moment, is it?
Yes, you can't see us.
No,
you
your picture.
We can, I think we can see him on the live stream.
Yeah, we can, on the live stream it works, so... Okay. So let's begin again. So an ECI is some sort of right you have as a citizen, as a European citizen. You can gather seven people together and try to launch an initiative. For that, you have to make sure that your initiative is one of the European Commission's competences. For example, environment, humanitarian aid, I don't know, fisheries, or for example, political rights, like we are doing. And then you have to register your idea to the commissions, and when it's done, you can define a date, starting date, and then you have 1 year to collect 1 million signatures from other European citizens all over the 27 EU countries. So basically, we can gather 1,000 signatures in France, 100,000 in Italy, 20,000 in Netherlands, etc., until we reach the 1 million signature package, let's say. And when it's done, the Commission will examine our initiative, and it will also be debated in the European Parliament. And if we have enough support behind us, then concrete measures will be taken and it will be an happy end, let's say. So for our initiative, Borders Without Borders, it's about political rights, but I think someone else can explain a little bit more about it.
Yes, great. I think you already gave us a lot of input, because you explained already what are the possible what is the possible follow-up of a successful ECI. So when you reach the 1 million signatures, the Commission is morally obliged to look into the proposal. So we have to make a distinguish. It's very different from a normal petition that you may sign every day on change.org or something, because it really has legislative power. And the Commission and the Parliament will, they can turn this proposal into a law. So that's why it also has some bit of a stricter regulation to follow up. And when you sign it, it's not just about putting your name and your email, and because everybody knows that you can kind of fake it with bots and stuff, but you are asked normally to put your ID number, because it's an official petition, and the member state, also the member state authorities, have to look into it and make sure those signatures are real. But yes, so back to the issue, the main issue. So the instrument is European Citizen Initiative. The issue is political rights, in particular for mobile EU citizens. But yeah, Claire, I think you're the one telling more about that.
Yes. The main goal is to improve the voting rights, the political rights of EU citizens, and because you joined this Facebook group, you know that EU citizens have the right to vote and stand in European and municipal election in their country of residence. But we realized that few of them didn't use the possibility, mainly because of administrative barriers, some language barriers, some to have the right documents, to respecting deadline and everything. And moreover, as a EU citizen, you cannot vote in regional, national, or in a referendum. And as you probably know, you pay, like everybody pay their taxes, maybe they send their kids to schools, they are running their businesses, but they can have a word in the regional or national politics. And for us, it's very bad. So yes, we saw in this Facebook group that there are a lot of voting rights experience, very, very bad voting rights experience. Some of us, like a Belgian who is obliged to vote in the election, even Susie was living in Spain for many years. Another who cannot vote in Vienna because it's not just a city, but also a province. So yes, that's our goal, like in short. I hope I explained clearly what is it, but because you are here, you know the what is this. Maybe like Robert, you as a Romanian citizen, you have some good example to tell us.
In terms of voting rights, my motivation to join this organization was also based on the fact that especially transnational citizens' voting rights are not entirely safeguarded as it should be. Even our current status quo of voting rights doesn't allow everyone the access to the voting pools. And here we can have the examples of when I relate it back to Romania, we can have multiple examples of people queuing up to the voting stations and not being allowed to vote, deliberately not being allowed to vote by our national government due to some technical difficulties which may or may not be orchestrated by our national governments. So I feel like this initiative is especially important for us, not only as Romanians, but also as Europeans, to safeguard the democracy in Europe and further enhance it to the level of holding accountable those that put a trap to the voting procedure. So in this regard, we believe that this will be only achieved through fair representation of every European which currently resides in another member state that its own. And this is obviously through political participation, after all. This is, after all, one of our goals, as well as safeguarding the votes. Political participation should be accessible also to those that reside in another member state, due to the fact that we represent about 17 million people, 17 million Europeans who currently live outside of their member state.
Yeah, definitely. It's about 4% of the EU working age population, which if you compare it, is maybe like the Netherlands and a little bit less, I think, than Romania in terms of numbers. So if everybody would vote in the European election, we could vote up to 26 MPs, so it's quite it's relevant, you know. I mean, if this initiative would be successful, it won't have a huge impact, but symbolically, I think it would mean a lot, because I mean, we are 17 million, but we are not that self-aware of that we are a community that contribute a lot economically, socially, and also culturally to the country we are living in. So we need to be to feel represented, I think, and to empower all EU citizenship citizens abroad to make their voice count, whether at home or in the country of residence, because that's also it's important for us to give choice to the citizens where they feel they feel they have more knowledge back home or in the country of residence. I mean, there may be thousands of different cases. You know, if you have lived for 20 years abroad, then you probably know more about your country of residence, politics, what's going on every day. Great. I think, anyway, I want to say to everybody that we are reading your comments. So if you have any question on this, you can just write them in the comments. We will read them and answer to you after. And yes, thanks to you guys, we are trying actually to make this community self-aware, because we are already 500 in this group and a lot of you already shared their stories. So I think we are doing something quite innovative here. And certainly we are growing, because our team is currently expanding in all countries and cities we haven't been to yet virtually. And so, yes, this is all part of our strategy to collect the signatures. I think Bastian will tell you a little bit more about the timeline of an ECI right now. So after we register, what is happening and how we are planning it, and then we'll tell you more strategically speaking about how we want to involve some of you guys, those of you who want to be involved.
Yes.
And that's it. So Bastian, go.
Yeah, sure. So it's quite easy. The reason, a lot of steps. Like, you have to submit your ID first to the European Commission, and then the institution decides whether or not it's in its competences. In our case, it was, so we managed this first step, and we were recognized as a valid initiative. From now on, we are considered as registered, and we can be found on the ECI website, official website, I mean. And then we have the possibility to choose a starting date for our 1 year campaign. We decided to set it up the 4th September of this year. And from this date, we'll have one entire year to campaign and collect 1 million signatures. So from 4th September 2020 to 3rd September 2021, 21st. So we'll have some sort of a preparatory phase until this date, the 4th September, and we are doing a lot of work here in Brussels and at home as well, trying to contact as much partners as possible. And then for the 1 year campaign, we'll try to collect signatures and still create a wide network of partners and collect signatures online as well as offline, but someone else will tell you a bit more on the strategy, I think.
Yes, I think Claire.
Yes, I can.
And tell us all about our target countries and such.
Yeah, like obviously, like it's we have to create a huge network and to launch this idea, this initiative among country, but we also need some citizen support, because 1 million signature is an impressive amount, and we know that we can't collect 1 million signature on our own. Yeah, us like 10 young European, we can't, like it's impossible. So we thought about a new tool, a new way of campaigning. It's like something innovative. And the thing is, like, do you know, like, the pyramid system? It's like a scam system. But we
normally, I think everybody knows it for, yes, in a negative.
In negative. No. We want to use this polemical tool for a democratic purpose. An European citizen initiative should not only come from a small group of EU citizens, but from all EU citizens. And for that, we want to make you, like, engage people, to make you participate in this, to make you ambassador of our initiative. With our system, everyone will be part of the initiative. So in summary, if each person who sign can convince 4 people to sign, we only need 10 level to get to reach the 1 million. As you can see on the graphic now, it's easy if we do in this system. The initiative is the level one and we are the level two. And if you are signing, guys, you on the Facebook group, you are the level three. And if you manage to convince four people in your turn, we already have more than six level to convince. So it's an easy target in this way. We think it could be a way to reach the million signature. And with everyone commitment, you are not just signatory, but you are also ambassador. You take the initiative as your own initiative. Convincing four people in your entourage, in your family, in your friends sphere is not so difficult. But with this system, the petition will be known all over Europe and it will spread by itself. So yes, imagine that just by convincing four people, you can get thousands of people under you to sign the petition. So yes, I prepared like another graphic and it's show the comparison between the if we will do alone the to convince people and if you guys convince people. The curve is exponential if you participate in our system. I don't know if I'm clear.
It's great, yes. Now because we have to say the what happened like a few days ago, actually this is quite a new and idea that we came up with. Like Claire came to us and she was like, guys, I don't know if you did the math, but if we are about, let's say, to collect 1,000 signatures a week, we will need like about 20 years to do that. I was like, okay, fuck, didn't think about that. And of course, like we don't have those millions because normally they say if you want in any petition, you know, you should have like 1 euro per signature. So we would need 1 million euro. But I think this is quite a new way to put and to engage, to make a European citizen initiative really by the citizen for the citizens. So it's great. And I think, of course, you are not the only people in this group. I mean, we are contacting thousands of student associations and young people, Erasmus students, everyone. So it will be a huge collective effort, but I think it will start. I mean, this group can be the nucleus for it and the
point. And if everybody is active and engaged and become a part of the initiative, it could be like very easy to get their signature. And I saw now that there is a question from Leah that she said like we will have some information already prepared to share to our choice four person. And I think yes, we will prepare a video or flyer to help you to convince these four people and to spread the initiative.
Yes. Thank you, Leah. I think, as you know, we're all young, so we're quite familiar with all the tools, communication, social media. So we will go full on that, like massively. We are about to launch the website now next week, so stay tuned for that. But we have a quite good team and we will try to do a catchy campaign with a lot of visual material. So that's one part of the strategy, yes. And then of course there is also some offline campaigning. I think you can tell more about that as well, like hopefully when all this pandemic will be over, we will be able to have one launch event at least in the 7 country that we most target, although we will collect signatures everywhere. So it's gonna be a different, I don't know, the signature will come from everywhere, but yes, I think this particular tool will be game changing. Maybe, I don't know, what do you think, guys?
Yeah, we will wait for your advice, for your opinion about that. But obviously, we can get the 17 million by our own. But like you, we can create a huge network, and by contacting people and contacting people, we can have these 17 million people on the moon.
I think it's also safe to say that we really cannot do it without you guys. So if you want to get involved more, we are here. We're always here, ready to answer your questions, ready to take on the initiative as well as you are. So if you've got any ideas, any strategies that can help us, don't hesitate to contact us on the group. And we're awaiting as well your participations.
Yes, and we're most glad also if you want to share anything on the group, anything related to the election in your country, because we feel like we have to relate to any contemporary thing that is going on in every country. So we know there are elections now in Italy, regional in October, then in Lithuania, and so so everything, all of this is it's obviously very important. Also in this moment, I think our campaign has gained like a plus, let's say, because with the pandemic, we realize how important, like how the nowadays issues are more than a national issue, so, you know, global warming, everything. It's not about where you vote, but it's about voting. That's it, you know, about the democratic principle of and everyone expressing their voice and try to influence, these global trends, I would say. So share your ideas, Guy. I don't know, it's super important for us, and we are glad for your feedback.
You had also two news, Christian, from Isabel. She's asking, like, do you already have a draft proposal, as in the actual text? And also from Francesco, he said, like, is there a specific quota of signature for every country according to the population? Maybe someone of you want to answer?
Yeah, me, for example. To answer Isabel, we already have a detailed program and everything what we ask exactly to the commission. You can find all that material, the reading material, on our website. For now, it is still under construction, but it will be live in 1 week, more or less. So I invite you to visit the website voterswithoutborders.eu a little bit later. In 1 week, it should be live, I think. And you can find all the details about what is our demands exactly, and a lot of other stuff, like some research if you are a bit curious, or even some articles that we have written here in the office at Brussels, where we share our experience in as Erasmus student, but also as European citizens. And maybe someone else for Francesco, questions?
Yes, I would just add to answer Isabel, like, yes, we, as Bastian said, okay, we have already some work done on how we would like the amendment, like the legislation to be changed. But we also put one specific request with this to do also more research on what the impact of extending those rights could be, because we realize there is a huge research gap. So we don't have many data on how many people are voting for European election back home or in the country of residence. Like, countries, the member states don't aggregate this data. So first of all, we would like to know more about that, to see actually where are the problems, like which are the main difficulties. It's very hard to know. We know that in some countries there is automatic registration, which facilitates the whole process, and some other everything run much slower, so a lot of gaps in all of this. So, but I think in terms of improving the existing rights of voting in local and European election, the legislation can be easily improved. I mean, more specific when it comes to extending the rights to national and regional election and referenda, then of course, the member states will have to come in play, and the legislation will have to be adopted by each member state. So that will depend. But the ECI will certainly, although not reaching the 1 million signature, will certainly trigger that discussion in many member states. So we're looking forward to a nice political debate also with the people who won't support this initiative, because of course there are plenty, I guess, that don't want to have foreigners voting in their country. Although I have to say they are not foreigners, because as again, we are all Europeans, so a big political community. And so I guess I went out
also, to digress a bit. To add on this, I think it is also safe to think about this initiative in a very realist manner, based on the fact that there is an increasing surge of a politicization movement of the immigration. So by politicizing immigration, here comes disinformation playing a role between us and shaping how we relate to one another. And also it is detrimental for us as Europeans, as well as national citizens, for the sake of accurate information, to open up the conversation as well as in the parliament, but also in politics. And this can only be done so if we also have equal political rights. And also saying, relating to this, guys, have we answered Francesco's question?
No, we didn't. But we can do it later. Yeah, continue. We'll do it just after.
Okay. Yeah, so in principle, due to the fact that there is an increasing surge of populism and an increasing surge of contestation against the European Union from our national politics, it is increasingly important for those that are themselves experiencing what it is to be European to have a say in this debate. Thank you.
Cool. Have we answered Francesco? I missed it.
No, we didn't. His question about quota of signatures and countries.
Indeed, yes. Good question. There is a quota in every country. And that also means that we have to be strategic of which country we choose for the signature collection, because, of course, the smaller countries have a smaller quota. So if we are able to get seven quarters in smaller country, then we can just go for the rest of the signatures everywhere. So I think in a way it makes sense for us to target first the smaller country, like maybe the Netherlands, Belgium, where they are quite active with the ECI already, because they know more about the tool. But then of course we are reaching out to those countries where a lot of expats resides, or a lot of expats come from, such as Romania, Italy, Lithuania, and Spain. I don't know, there are plenty. So yes. More questions? Nope. Okay, I think we said everything we wanted to talk about for now. I'm sure we will come back soon, I guess, with another live. But I hope for those who were here, we explained everything, and maybe you will help us also enlarge this group so that next time we will be much more numerous. But again, thank you so much.
Yes, and if you want to participate more in our strategy, in our campaign, we are glad to welcome you. And we thought about new challenges in our Facebook group. So if you are here to be as a community, to be active, we will be happy to communicate with you, to e-meet you again. Obviously, there is a new question now. Do you have any activity in the future to make your initiative more accessible to mass and increase its notoriety? From Isabel.
Yes, we did so far. Of course, we have to, especially now during the whole COVID crisis, we mostly had to improvise in the previous months our strategy in terms of getting more notoriety. But in the future, depending on the lifting of lockdowns, we will create events, and we will do our best to enhance this initiative to the larger public. So far in May, we had to present this initiative to the European Youth event. But of course, due to the crisis, this has been cancelled, and there were many events alike where we could have unleashed our potential, so to speak. But we are looking forward for the future ones. If you guys want to add something on it, of course.
I mean, we are trying to link to any possible national events about youth participation, active citizenship, voting rights campaign. There is a growing network now of European voting rights campaign that they're like from different cities just coming together. And I think thanks to those, we will be able to go in the local, let's say, because for now we are a transnational group, we have some transnational partners, but maybe our weakness for now it's still the local, like how to reach to all those cities everywhere in Europe. So we are certainly working on that and also open for suggestions. And a big part of also of the strategy comes with fundraising. So for more events, we are also trying to fundraise. EU fundings are one part of it, but then we need to get every help possible, every euro count, not 1 million, but anything really. So yes, you will find that also on the website. Maybe you know someone, some very wealthy men who just want to help some young people. So no, I'm kidding, but yeah, I think that's it. That's all from my side.
Yeah, I think it's all for today. We did a great job. And once again, we would like to thank you all for being here today, and equally for people watching the video and not only be here on the live. Maybe you can assist the live next time, so we'll be happy to see you and chat with you, interact with you. And once
maybe
again,
instead of a live, we could do like a chat, like a room, I don't know, a Facebook room where we can have a beer together.
Yeah, don't hesitate to send us any message on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram as well. As you can see on the bottom, you can find us everywhere on this platform. And yeah, don't hesitate also to share your stories, talk your friend about us, etc., etc., and just share the content if you like the idea. We would be grateful if you could do that.
Yep. Cool. So thanks everybody, and goodbye from all the team of Voters Without Borders.
And remember, we cannot do it without you.
Yeah.
Goodbye, goodbye everyone. And any questions you have further, drop them in a post on the group. Thank you very much.
See you with our video again, so enjoy it and feel powerful after watching it. See you.